Good morning, everybody. This is the Personal Playlist Podcast, fondly referred to as the P3, on VoiceEd Radio. I'm Noah Daniel.
Music is a world within itself, with a language we all understand.
I am so excited to have Sean Gaillard here on the Personal Playlist Podcast. Sean is an educator and author. His first book, called The Pepper Effect, is being published this June by Dave Burgess Consulting Inc. His 26 years in education have spanned from teaching English in various middle and high schools to school leadership. Currently, Sean is the principal of Lexington Middle School in Lexington, North Carolina. Sean is also the founder of the hashtag Celebrate Monday, which sets the most beautiful tone for a week in education and beyond. He's presented at ISTE, the National School Board Association, and recently keynoted at EdCamp Charlotte. It has been a long time coming, so I'm beyond thrilled to welcome Sean Gaillard here to the Personal Playlist Podcast. Welcome, Sean.
Oh, hello, Noah. Thank you so much. It's so good to be here, and I'm happy to be here, and I'm excited, and long time fan, first time caller. And let's do it. I'm stoked.
Okay, well, I want to begin with the hashtag Celebrate Monday, because I actually read an ISTE publication from 2016 where you talked about how you came to this idea and asked the question, what if we celebrated Mondays? And every Monday, I look forward to channeling whatever comes to me onto the landscape of this conversation. And I love what people put out there. And it really is the positive vibe for the whole week. How did it come to be?
Well, thank you for saying that. And I appreciate that. Celebrate Monday came out of my reading a book called School Culture Rewired, and it was written by Todd Whitaker. I'm sure a lot of your listeners are familiar with Todd and his work with What Great Principals Do Differently or What Great Teachers Do Differently. And he co-wrote this beautiful book with Steve Grunert, who is an education professor in Indiana. And I am obsessed with culture. I'm obsessed with finding new ways to uplift our kids and to uplift our teachers. And I'm always that geek in the education section in any given bookstore, just thumbing through books. So when this book arrived to me, I was thumbing through it and came across, when you read a book and they'll have like a quote in bold print or in the center of a page. And this particular quote stood out to me. You can bust a culture if you celebrate Mondays. And that just kind of just struck me. It was a true epiphany. And at that time, that was where I was principal at my first school, Wiley, in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. And I was looking for ways to uplift our staff at the time. We'd been going through a whole lot, school turnaround process, change leadership, all those things were happening. And I remember thinking, wow, this could be something that our school could do. We could celebrate Mondays. And instead of using Monday as an excuse to be negative or grouchy, I mean, my goodness, this is a school. We're talking about kids. And a schoolhouse should be really the primary place to bring joy and love and upbeatedness, if that's a word. So I thought, man, let's celebrate Monday as a school. We'll start the week off on a high note, and so high that we're going to keep the momentum going through the week. And so it started off as a school experiment, which then became, and I didn't understand the power of Twitter at the time, but it became this kind of this potboiler, this little trending phenomenon that other schools have taken on, and I'm very honored and grateful for that. So Celebrate Monday kind of has gone from a school experiment to help out my kids to really a love letter, or what I want it to be. I want it to be a love letter to the world, or a love letter for the world.
You're the stone that causes this beautiful ripple that I love being a part of. And speaking about being a part of, you know, uplifting is something that you just do, whether you're talking about leadership or you're writing in your blog, you uplift people. And when I first came onto Twitter, I was trying to figure it all out, and I discovered EdBeat, and it was a life changer. So you and Natalie Cravenger had a chat that literally rocked, and you equated music and education. And I had so much fun with it. One week I did a lyrics only answer.
That's
just
right.
Because I could. And it was just like, how is it possible that I could be talking to cool people about cool music and education? And it was so life affirming, and it was so professionally affirming. What, how did that ever come to be?
Well, again, it goes back to a school experiment, and stepping into, the PLN world and modeling that for our staff. So, I got involved in Twitter, as a principal, really as a mechanism to share the positive things that were happening in our schoolhouse. Again, I was at the time, principal of a school where, there was a lot of negative press, a lot of negative perceptions in the community, and the local traditional press corps was not circling my school anytime anything great was happening, which was on any given day. So I got tired of that, of waiting around. And, I thought, you know, I see all these other schools and organizations do chats. So why don't we do a school chat and just share the good things that we're doing? So we called it Wiley Chat, and named after my beloved first school, where I was principal. And I intended to just do that for a few weeks or so and then be done with it. But then I noticed that there were other people that were coming into the conversation gratefully from other parts of the globe. Again, the power of a PLN and Twitter. And, I remember when Wiley Chat, ceased to exist, other people were asking, well, where's Wiley Chat? When's it coming back? So, that's what really started. I figured, well, if other people are immersed in this, and I want to be inclusive, and I just don't want to single non Wiley school people out, I'll create another chat and call it EdBeat, which, I figured there was no place out in the Twitterverse that was doing anything with music and education. And that's what I wanted to see. And that's what I wanted to do. And those are two things and I know you're passionate about as well. So I fused those together. I started off with, you know, just different collaborators, and Natalie was one who we just had a kind of a mutual understanding when it came to music. We were both music geeks. We were both passionate about education, still are. And that the mindset of EdBeat was like, we are, and Natalie and I used to say this, we're the used record store, or the 7-Eleven 24-hour convenience store, where you can come in, get a Slurpee, listen to some music, talk to some cool people. It's okay to be a geek. It's okay to be passionate about kids. And we're going to, you know, if we're going to do a chat celebrating Fleetwood Mac, okay, let's do it. If we're going to do a chat with, you know, man, what would EdBeat be like if we had this person on? What would that be like? That's what EdBeat was. So I'm very, very honored and happy by that time. That was a great experience, and a lot of great friendships, and learning came out of that. Really, really sweet, glorious time of conversation. And it's also kind of cool to see folks that were affiliated with that chat kind of going on to other things, bigger things, whether it's writing a book or starting their own chat or starting their own podcast about music. There's a certain edge. Oh, yes, this. Yes. P3. Yeah.
You know, when I started reading your blogs and really, I mean, I love music, but not like you love music. You love music in a deeply knowledgeable and passionate way. And so when you you know, take a metaphor and you're writing about the Beatles or the Eagles or whomever, you're writing about a song, a band, you have such deep connections. So then the Pepper Effect started to evolve through your blogs, I guess. And yes. Then what made you decide to take it to the next level, turning it up to 11?
Oh, yes. These all go to 11. For all of you Spinal Tap fans out there, we apologize. Or if you're not a Spinal Tap fan, we apologize. But no, we don't apologize because it's Tap into America. The Pepper Effect. Well, that thank you for reading my blog, Principal Liner Notes. That came out of again, the power of Twitter. I use Twitter, you know, to share my passions and to hopefully find a friend or find kinship. And so that came out of that, me just sharing a tweet about the Beatles Magical Mystery Tour around the time of the 50th anniversary of Sergeant Pepper. So it has always been a dream of mine to write a book. It's always been a dream. That has been a lifelong dream since really fifth grade. And so I'm very blessed and grateful to have this happen. I still can't believe that it's happened, and I still can't believe that this kind of a book is getting ready to come out in the universe. So I blog, I write whenever I can, and I thought that there was something there that could be the material for a book, and I was very fortunate that Dave and Shelley Burgess, who are amazing and supportive when it comes to dreams, they were like the Willy Wonka to my Charlie, and they just gave me the chocolate factory, I feel like I'm just sitting on five golden tickets in a room full of Oompa Loompas, and I've got the Pepper Effect.
I'm so excited for you. And, you know, when I saw your songs, I shouldn't have been surprised, but, you know, the idea of the show is people send me three songs, one that's nostalgic, one that reflects your identity, and one that lifts you up, picks you up, inspires you. And it was amazing to see and even think about the process of you getting to choose only three songs from your large repertoire, but also in this way. So let's begin with your nostalgic song. This song was a really different song, influenced by, you know, Lennon's interest, I guess all the Beatles' interest in transcendental meditation. And that's why he added, I guess, that Sanskrit mantra in it. Why did you choose this song as your nostalgic song?
Well, that was probably, I mean, you know, the next show has got to be like P57 because that's how many songs. That's how many songs I was like swimming around. And but anyway, I figured Across the Universe is off of what's considered to be the last Beatles officially released album, and that album, Let It Be, is considered to be their most. A lot of people hate that album because it was kind of cobbled together. Phil Spector, was brought in to produce the album or to kind of piece the album together because it was the recording sessions, which turned out to be the last time the Beatles performed live in public. The recording sessions were fraught with animosity and negativity, and essentially the band was breaking up, and they, you know, kind of like a rough draft for a paper or a half baked cake, they just kind of took those recording sessions and put it on the shelf and said and wanted to forget about it. So they brought in Phil Spector, the famous Wall of Sound producer, because there was a movie contract. They were going to make they were making a documentary or film about that album. They had to pull together a very, a companion album, if you will. But a lot of fans just don't like that album, even though there are great songs on that album. But I love that album because for two reasons. One, It was released on the same day that I was born, May 8th, 1970. Yeah. And so I like to think of myself, even though I wasn't part of the, you know, screaming fans and I was not a, I'm not a contemporary of the Beatles. I like to think that I just made it in, into the world, for the same time as this band. So, So that I had to in picking this, I had to include my favorite Beatles album, and a lot of people give me quizzical looks when I say that, but there's a very personal reason. The other reason why, and Across the Universe is a beautiful song and reflects, you know, Lennon's, exploration with the other Beatles, as you mentioned, into transcendental meditation. And when they went to India to study with the Maharishi, the song is poetry. But most importantly, the song appeared as the lullaby, as on a lullaby Beatles lullaby album created by Jason Faulkner, for all you Jellyfish fans out there. And Across the Universe is actually one of my is one of the favorite songs of my twin daughters, and we used to play that song, that particular rendition. All the time when they were babies. So every time I hear that song, I think of running to Barnes and Noble when they were born in 2003, and I was with my oldest daughter Maddie, who was 4 at the time. I'm getting a little emotional thinking about this, and how I found this album, The Bedtime for Beatles. Recorded by Jason Faulkner, and I just picked it up immediately. And I remember Maddie and I, because Maddie is if you're one of my kids, you're going to be a Beatles fan. So it's a prerequisite in the Gaillard family. And, I remember driving back, and it was a rainy day. It was the day after they were born, and Maddie and I, we were rushing home to clean up our apartment. And, I put that album on, you know, if you remember those little disc, the Discman, you remember that, you know, and you put it in and you hook it up to your car and scratch up the CD. I remember playing that song and just, yeah, it was very emotional. That was a moment I had with my daughter and looking forward to the twins coming home. And then that album became a lullaby fixture to the point where today the twins are now, they're going to be 15 in a few weeks. Anytime Across the Universe comes on, whether it's the Beatles version or if we come across the Jason Faulkner version, they get very lethargic and we get very nostalgic together, and we start, you know, and I'll start telling them about the day they were born and those things. So it's a very personal song for me.
All right. Born of the Beatles, Across the Universe.
Like endless rain into a paper cup, they slither wildly as they slip away across the universe. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy are drifting through my opened mind, possessing and caressing me.
Change my
actually didn't know some of the things I learned about this next song that you call your identity song, but that it had been originally recorded as a demo, and then the Beatles finished it 17 years later, only to be a lead single for the anthology project. In terms of your identity, how does this song tell your story?
Well, as a longtime Beatles fan, and I've been a fan of them, oh my gosh, going on 40 years now. You always have, if you talk to any Beatle fan, okay, if they're saying something differently, then they're lying. But we all want to be the fifth Beatle. Every Beatle fan has this fantasy of being on stage, being in the band, and, you know, sitting across from Ringo or John or Paul. You know, I mean, I still have those dreams, and I used to have a recurring dream. I still do, actually, where the Beatles have invited me to perform with them, and they're my best friends, and I'm rushing to the concert hall or the stadium where the reunion is supposed to take place, and I'm hearing this beautiful music, and I hear Paul going, and now we're going to introduce our friend Sean Gaillard, and here he is, and the crowd goes wild, but I can't get into the stadium. You know, I can't get in. So yeah, I can't get in, or if I get in the stadium, I get lost. So again, that's like another Spinal Tap reference. Hello, Cleveland. But anyway, so when Free as a Bird came out in 95, which, you know, if you know the Beatles story, they didn't have the best breakup. It was very bitter. It took years of wrangling with lawsuits, and I mean, John and Paul were exchanging, writing negative songs about each other. Most famously in John's 1971's "How Do You Sleep." So, and you know, when John was killed, you know, sadly, any hope of a reunion with the four of them had ended. And that was something that they were plagued with, you know, post breakup. Are you going to get back together? And there were these rumors and things. So as a second generation Beatles fan, you know, I ate all of that stuff up. I still do. And when Free as a Bird came out, you know, with Paul, George, and Ringo getting together in the same room is a big deal. Getting together with an unfinished demo of John's that he wrote, you know, circa 1977, and finishing that song and adding their own, you know, adding new lyrics, adding their harmonies, and you know, again, it shows the solidarity and brotherhood of that band and the friendship. How, yeah, we're going to get together, but we have to have John involved in this in some way because he's so much a part of our DNA as a band. That song for me is always a reminder that the impossible can become possible. And if I look back in my life, if I look back in my time as a person, as a dad, as a husband, as an educator, that always kind of echoes, you know. For me, you know, I'm always pushing against the grain in some way. I'm always trying to make something that is impossible possible in some way. And sometimes I fail at it. Sometimes I'm successful. And it also, you know, the song is positive. And I like to default to positivity as much as possible. And I think that's so much a part of my identity. So without much further ado, Free as a Bird, man.
Thank you.
much in that song that must have given you solace as a Beatles fan with the idea of them coming together. I actually know that Yoko Ono hand delivered the tapes to Paul as like a gesture to kind of remind him and the world that she was not the person who broke up the Beatles.
Yes, absolutely. And that, what a powerful gesture. I mean, if anything, she got them back together. And oh, there's so much love in that song and so much majesty there. And I remember when that song debuted on the Beatles anthology, and I remember not believing that they were together. And it hit, I still get chills at that moment when Paul sings "Whatever Happened to the Life We Once Knew," and then you go, "Oh, it's a Beatles song," you know, because, you know, up to that moment, it's just John singing and the instrumentation, you know, it's not very Beatle-y distinctive. But when every time Paul comes into that moment and you go, okay, it's the Beatles. This is a big deal.
I think it's a big deal to always look for the horizon of possibility and positivity. And I know that you've done some incredible work. You've turned a school around and you're always there for the kids, and everything that you do in your leadership role and in your role on social media and your role in your writing always comes back to being there for the children.
Yes.
But sometimes we need songs that, you know, pick us up or lift us up. I like that you called it uplifting. Of all the songs in your Beatles collection, why this one?
Because I've been swimming in the marrow that is the Pepper Effect, I figured I would be remiss if I did not include a song from that album. And And really the Pepper Effect, and I'll give you and your listeners a little bit of a taste of what that book is, and where the song, where I'm coming from with the song. Even though I'm a Beatles geek, and it's very evident here, and I'm a music geek, there is an inspirational thread that educators can draw from in the Beatles, and if it's not the Beatles for others, I really believe it has to be something. You know, we have to draw inspiration and motivation from something. So if it's not the Beatles, or, you know, if it's, you know, Seinfeld or the band Rush or Flintstone Vitamins or whatever it may be, you've got to draw inspiration from something. So for me, the Beatles, at the time when they created Sergeant Pepper's was a very fluid and provocative and hip time, and they just didn't come up with that album, that masterpiece, overnight. You know, they really, you know, it took a lot of courage. It took them, for one, and one part of the Pepper Effect is believing in their vision and having a clear vision of a band and what they wanted to do. And I think that's important for educators, whether you're a school leader or teacher. You need to not only have a vision, but you need to believe in it. And you need to believe in it with your mind, heart, body, and soul, and especially when it comes to doing what I feel is the most noble of all professions. So believe in your vision. And the Beatles did that with Sgt. Pepper. Let's make an album that's not us. Let's make an album that is going to be different. Let's make an album that is going to incorporate all of our influences without restraint. The second part of the Pepper Effect is to believe in your masterpiece. And although I don't think the four of them woke up, you know, especially when they recorded the next song that we're going to listen to, I don't think they said, "Hey, this is a masterpiece," but I think they approached it, the recording of that album, with the mindset of someone like a Michelangelo or a Da Vinci or a Romare Bearden, you know, where this is an artwork that we're doing, and we're going to incorporate an orchestra, and we're going to incorporate poetic lyrics, and we're going to do these avant-garde things. And I really believe that, believing in your masterpiece is the same mindset that we need to have as educators. That and that that also kind of speaks a little bit to your building outside the blocks thing, where the school is a masterpiece. The school is this place for creativity, for kids, for teachers, and let's do some things that have never been done before. And I believe that's what makes a masterpiece. It's something that's bold and innovative and sets precedent. The third thing is to believe, the third thing in the pep effect is to believe in your collaborators. And I write about this in the book, how when the Beatles recorded Sgt. Pepper's, they retreated to the studio, they stopped touring, and the press began to speculate out loud, who are these guys? What are they doing? They're washed up, they're dried up. And Paul McCartney shares how they would read these articles during the recording of Sgt. Pepper's, and they would kind of say, you just wait. We can't wait for you to hear this album. And I think a lot of that comes to them believing in each other and believing in themselves as a band, that we are capable of doing something great and different and creative. The same thing that an educator should do. You need to believe in your collaborators and believe in their talents and strengths and trend the positive, celebrate Monday, build outside the blocks, right? And support each other in doing that. And then the fourth thing, which kind of echoes the same thing I talked about, ignore naysayers. And the Beatles did that. They followed their own beat, especially with the song, which is really out there in many ways, but also has stood the test of time as a separate work of poetry and art. And I think, even though naysayers may have some merit as individuals, and we don't want to dismiss their personhood, But we have to ignore that negativity. We can't let that negativity define us or shape us. And I think the Beatles did that masterfully with the Sgt. Pepper album and that time period in which they created this what Rolling Stone magazine has called the greatest album of all time. And Sgt. Pepper's has been often emulated and has served as inspiration for other great works. And I hope the book itself will inspire others. And I hope this song will as well. That's kind of where I came from in choosing this particular song.
Okay, well, here is a rare Beatles song with the title not part of the lyrics, A Day in the Life.
fell out of bed, dragged a comb across my head. Found my way downstairs and drank a cup, and looking up, I noticed I was late. Found my coat and grabbed my hat, made the bus in seconds flat. Found my way upstairs and had a smoke, and somebody spoke and I went into a dream.
Cut that song off.
No. Oh man.
This has been a wonderful time. Sean is an avid blogger, passionate fan of music. You can follow him on Twitter at SM Gaillard and his blog Principal Liner Notes. Sean lives in North Carolina with his wife Deborah and their three daughters. You wrote Music Heals. It's the universal band-aid for a broken heart, negative filled day, or loss of a loved one. Music Inspires. It's the soundtrack for creation, joy, and a myriad of catalytic moments etched in blessed warm memories. I'm sure that your book encapsulates all of those things. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us on the P3 today. Is there anything you want to add before I play you out?
Oh, I've just really enjoyed this conversation, and I am so grateful for you and to be able to build and speak and learn and listen outside the blocks. And I just love being in the band with you. And and the cool thing about all this is, you know, music, I really believe this, music is the divine universal language. And here we are being joined by this mutual love for music and education. I'm so grateful for this conversation. I'm grateful for you.
I am so grateful for this time with you. Thank you so much for coming out. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us on the P3, the Personal Playlist Podcast. I'm Noah Daniel. This is Voice Ed Radio, and I hope you have a fantastic day.